So Dr. Bansi, I would like to thank you for advocacy of type 1 diabetes, because there's hardly any other conference where the main hall is dedicated or we get a platform to talk about type 1 diabetes. So I think I'm really honored. And so this talk, we are going to start this whole symposium with a very basic talk, what not to miss for our clinicians. So all the clinicians who are sitting here, I will talk about strategies to improve awareness and care for all of you. So I'm not preaching, but there'll be certain messages at the end of my, you know. So what is type 1 diabetes? It's a chronic autoimmune disease in which loss of beta cell mass and subsequent insulin insufficiency lead to hyperglycemia. Now, most 75% of our patients with type 1 are aged less than 19. And so the hallmark of type 1 diabetes is a deficiency of insulin secretion. And it still remains the most common diabetes in the young, although now we are seeing more and more type 2 diabetes in the young. So now classification of type 1, we know it can be classified into autoimmune type 1A and type 1B when antibodies are present or antibodies are absent. Now for the audience, I would like to tell you that even in a place like Delhi, we are not doing all the antibodies. So Dr. Archana Sarda is here as a chairman, and I would like to ask her later. So in Delhi, very few labs are doing all the antibodies. So what I would like to reiterate is, if there are classic symptoms of type 1 diabetes, antibody negative type 1 is common. Also, now that we are doing more and more antibodies, we've seen that zinc transporter 8 antibodies may be positive, which you are not doing. And some of the patients are now, who were labeled as type 1B, are being labeled as type 1A or autoantibody positive type 1 diabetes. So type 1 diabetes in India estimated, these are the number of cases that are estimated, 0.25 to 0.5 million cases. There's a regional variation, but there's an increasing trend. How do you diagnose? We all know, with the fasting plasma glucose, a glycosylated hemoglobin, or you could do a random plasma glucose test. Now, these are the common antibodies, the GAD65 antibodies, the insulinoma-associated antibody 2, the insulin autoantibodies, and the zinc transporter 8 antibodies. Now, what are the limitations of autoantibodies? Like I just told you, all the patients, all antibodies, expensive. Then you can't do all antibodies even in metro cities. Some antibodies may not be done. So the problem is, if the patient is a classic case of type 1, you need not do the antibody. So the first message and the second test that we do is C-peptide in type 1 diabetes. The C-peptide level assesses the insulin production in the patient. So the C-peptide is low and it may be absent in a type 1 diabetes. And so this is important. But initially, when the patient has presented, there may be some residual beta cell mass and there may be some detectable levels of C-peptide in the type 1 diabetic patient also. So again, C-peptide levels also don't help us in diagnosing type 1 diabetes, because there are limitations of C-peptide testing, variability in the results or the values. So there's a honeymoon phase in type 1 diabetes, which means that there is some residual beta cell mass and the C-peptide level may be preserved for some time, and the patient may not need insulin for a while or may need a very small dose when the patient is unwell or has some other problem. So first message is, right diagnosis at the right time is crucial. We cannot miss type 1 diabetes. There have been trials in siblings of type 1 diabetic patients where we've done autoantibodies, but as a rule, I do not test autoantibodies in the siblings, because that just raises the stress level in the parent if one child is diabetic and you get autoantibodies in the other. So we don't do it as a routine. There may be people who differ. Dr. Sujoy is here, so we'll listen to him whether he does it routinely. But one thing is sure, if you have one sibling with type 1 diabetes, you can discuss, and I'm sure the parents are aware and they know. So routine antibody testing in the sibling of type 1 patient is not recommended and rather not done. Now, one more message here is that any age you can get type 1. So we do see adult patients, and I saw a patient, I was following up for type 1 diabetes for almost 15 years. Her mother was diagnosed with diabetes. She was treated as type 2, and eventually we found that her C-peptides were low. Her GAD antibodies were positive, and the mother at the age of 49 years developed type 1 diabetes. So no age is immune from type 1. We have to keep our antenna open so that. Now coming to the management, it's a teamwork. We have to start basal bolus. So from this platform, I'm repeating, there is no other insulin but basal bolus. When people say our patient could not afford a basal bolus, it's not possible, because you can use any bolus. You can even use regular insulin as bolus. When you're using regular insulin as bolus, or you're using NPH as basal, which of course has to be given twice, it's still basal bolus. So from this platform, I request two things. One is, basal bolus therapy is the way forward for the clinicians, because my job is to convince the clinicians about diagnosis, management, and what else can they do in their clinics. So basal bolus need not be expensive insulins. You could use the regular insulin bolus. You could use NPHS basal, using it twice. You could use extempore insulin. And of course, if your patient can afford, you could use U100 glargine as basal, or you could use the newer second generation insulins as basals. So nutrition in type 1 diabetes is very important. And there are variables affecting blood sugar, like the dietary carb. So we must initiate the conversation, and none of us can call ourselves type 1 specialist in diabetes if we do not give nutrition advice. So you, in the first or second visit, you should talk to the patient and the attendant about carbs, fats, proteins, what are complex carbs, what are starches, what are sugars, what carbs can be taken, how to bring down the glycemic index, what about the glycemic load. So all this is very important. You can take the help of a nutritionist, or you can start reading about it, because now you have several apps where carb counting is possible, carb content of food can be calculated. So these are various, so the approaches to insulin management. Healthy nutrition, I just told you, there's nothing called a diabetic diet. The parents should be eating, or the other siblings should be eating, what the type 1 diabetic patient is going to eat. So we are going to talk about carbs, fats, proteins, and we will not discourage the patient from eating. Now, counting carbs again is important. So because we know that a fruit can straight away go to the bloodstream, starch will take 2 hours, high fiber starch can take 2.5 hours. So we can bring down the glycemic index of foods by adding vegetables. So all these things are important. Again, my message to all of you is nutrition is basic, and you have to learn, you have to talk about nutrition to your type 1 diabetic patient. Yes, exercise recommendations are important, importance of daily activity. You can't scare the parent of a type 1 saying that he cannot exercise. Of course, what is important is self-monitoring of blood glucose. So the child should check before exercising, maybe during exercise and after exercise. So that's important. The message is self-monitoring of blood glucose is very important. So again, always insulin, no tablets, basal bolus and nothing else, at least 3 boluses, if not 4. Why 4 boluses? Because some children go to school early at 7 o'clock. They need some breakfast there. In school, they will have a meal with the other students. Oh, they need a bolus there. The third bolus is in the afternoon when they come back at 3 o'clock, and the fourth bolus before dinner, and a basal to cover the needs throughout the day. So don't hesitate from giving boluses. And this is the attempt to mimic physiological insulin profile. So you have to give a basal bolus. Premix should not be given a type 1 diabetic patient. We know the advantages of basal bolus. Very, very simple to titrate. The patient calculates the carbs in the meal, and depending on the insulin carb ratio, they take the insulin doses before the meal. If the meal is deferred for some time, you can defer the insulin dose. So carb counting, I can teach you a little bit of carb counting through one. So yeah, these are studies to show that if you teach your patient to dose adjust for normal eating, this was known as the Daphne study. Teaching flexible intensive insulin treatment always results in better outcomes. So how do you treat the patient? I'll tell you in this steps to carb counting. Identify foods containing carbs. So in a thali, ask the patient first, teach him to identify that yes, even the dal or the lentils have lenta carbs. The roti has carbs. You have vegetables which have lesser carbs, but they do have carbs. Even dairy has carbs. So you can identify the carbs. That's the first step. Then calculate the total carbs in the meal. So suppose the patient is taking one roti, then you can say 15 grams of carb, two rotis, 30 grams, or rice. You can calculate the amount of carbs in the meal, and then we'll teach you how to calculate the insulin carb ratio. Now, calculate the insulin for the meal, depending on the insulin carb ratio and the insulin sensitivity index, how much dose that the patient need before the meal. Then, is a correction dose needed? Correction factor should be taken into account. Now, what is a correction dose? Very simple to understand. If the target sugar before a meal is 140, but the sugar is 200, so we need to correct the insulin dose. So if he was planning to take 6 units, the insulin sensitivity index is, say, 30. That means 1 unit of insulin brings down the sugar by 30. You should add a correction of 2 units if you want to bring it down by 60. So correction doses have to be given. Now, how do you calculate insulin? This is very simple, and you can look at the slide. 50 kg child, insulin carb ratio, this is fixed, 500 divided by the total daily dose. So if his total daily dose is 50, which means he takes, say, 10 units of regular insulin 3 times, 30, and 20 units of U100 glargine, the dose becomes 50. So total daily dose, 500 divided by the total daily dose is 10 grams of carb, which means that 1 unit of insulin is needed for every 10 grams of carb. So if a patient is taking, say, 70 grams of carb, two rotis, like I told you, 30 grams, some vegetable, 5 grams, curd, 5 grams, if he's taking, depending on the insulin carb ratio, you can inject insulin. Now, what is insulin sensitivity index? If the patient is on analog insulins, it's calculated by 1800 divided by the total daily dose, which is 50 in this case. So the answer is 36, which means 1 unit of insulin will bring down the sugar by 36. So if the sugar is, instead of 140, is 180, you can give a correction dose of 1 unit. So this you have to teach, and again the message is basal bolus therapy is only recommended treatment in type 1 and carb counting is crucial. Now these are the glycemic targets. We must remember time and range. I still have 1.5 minutes. Time and range is important. Now that we are using flash glucose monitors and we are doing, so most of our patients are on these monitors where you can actually see the blood sugars if they scan. Time in range in a type 1 diabetic patient. Now, what is time in range? So if suppose you've decided the time 70 to 180 is, he should be in range for at least 70%. Then time below range are two. One is grade 1 hypoglycemia, which is a blood sugar of less than 70. And grade 2 hypoglycemia, blood sugar of less than 54. Similarly, grade 1 hyperglycemia is more than 180, but less than 250. And grade 2 hyperglycemia is more than 250. So a type 1 diabetic should be in range for 70% of the time, less than 1% of 24 hours, which translates to only 15 minutes. He should be less than 54. So hypoglycemia should not be more than 15 minutes or 1% of the 24 hours. Similarly, more than grade 2 hyperglycemia should be less than 5%. That means more than 250. So these are the time in range goals. Glucose monitoring is very important. You have to be empathetic to the patient, but you have to be sure they check before every meal. These are the benefits of self-monitoring. Only when you monitor, you realize it is high. Only when you realize it is high, you can give a correction dose. Then the patient knows that it is high because I ate something wrong. So the answer is empowering the patient and the family. So glucose monitoring is important. And of course, psychological support is very important. Well-being assessment. We do have type 1 diabetic with a lot of mental health issues, particularly if they feel they are a financial burden to their families. So we believe in accountable care. Just writing a treatment is not enough. You have to be accountable for what you're doing. You must reach the HbA1c target. And this is the PENTAD cluster program. So this is one slide I would like to concentrate. Patient is important, the physician is important, the parents are important in the management of type 1, the peer is important, the peer could be a sibling or a friend, and the psychologist or the team is important, and you can add a sixth P, the principal and the teachers of the school are important because they also help if the patient has hypoglycemia or if the patient has hyperglycemia. He need not be ostracized for going to the washroom more often than he can. So my last slide, be the one everyone can count on. If you are passionate about type 1, please treat. Otherwise, please refer to an endocrinologist trained in managing type 1 diabetes or a diabetologist who's passionate. So this is very clear. And from this platform, I say we have a very passionate ambassador of type 1, Dr. Archana Sarda here. And through this platform, I'd like to reiterate that if you want to learn management of type 1, yes, go ahead, learn nutrition, learn carb counting, learn insulin sensitivity index, but you'll need to give a lot of time. And you should have a diabetes support group, both offline and online. We do have several support groups, and we should build a support chain. So management of type 1 diabetes is beyond writing a prescription. It's a holistic approach, it's a team effort, and you need a support chain like the cluster pentad that I told you, that you do need a counselor in your team. You need a lot of people to help the type 1 diabetic patient. So for your, so that's the last slide. But I like to reiterate from this platform that now I'm seeing more and more type 1s studying, married, and pregnant. So the challenges are still there, because the challenge of delivering a healthy baby for a type 1 diabetic patient is immense. So I think from this platform, I like to tell all the clinicians, don't forget to diagnose type 1, even in the older individual. Keep your antenna up. If they're not responding to oral drugs, if they have no stigma of metabolic syndrome, if do the C-peptides. If not, you can't do it. You can't do the antibodies and the C-peptide. At least keep your antenna open. Even older individuals can be type 1. Thank you.